in polynomial, in ordinary differential equation can be solved using the boundary problems, because you know that any ordinary differential equation, for example, let us see that dy by dx equal to fxy, any derivative equation, differential equation can be solved with the help of the boundary problems. And boundary problems in the sense that you have to give the initial conditions as well as the boundary equations, right? So in polynomial we used to carry out the ordinary differential equation. The function is your ODE, right? So in ODE, as I am showing you here, in ODE, first parameter is your y naught, that is your initial value of y, when y actually you have to carry out, you have to find out y, right? T naught is your the initial time at which the y naught, what is y naught that you should have. After that, t is your vector, that at which time you want the value of y, and f is a function. Now let me just write a mathematical equation, then only you will understand that how it can be written, right? What do you mean by that? So for example, that is your dy by dx equal to 2x minus 1. This is an equation, right? Dy by dx equal to 2x minus 1. So what is our motive? Our motive is to find out the solution, right? And to find out y at x equal to 4, right? So find out y, first of all, you have to solve for y, to find out y. And then you have to find out what is the value. What is the value of y at x equal to 4, right? This is our motive. Whenever we find out that you solve this equation, that means from dy by dx, you have to find out that what is y. And after that, you have to find out that what is the value of y at x equal to 0, x equal to 4, x equal to 1, x equal to 2, x equal to any matrix also it can be given. So for this, you want that initial value. Initial value in the sense, for example, y at, I am giving initial condition y3 equal to, for example, minus 5. So this is my initial value. That means y3 is your initial value, right? And at time x equal to 3, that means in t naught, it will come as 3. And in y naught, it will come as your minus 5, right? That means if it is given as 0, that means if it is given y naught equal to, minus 5, then automatically we will give, in y naught, we will give minus 5. And in t0, we will give only 0 instead of 3. And if it is given y3, then we will give minus 5. And at time t naught means at time x naught, that is your at time x equal to 3. This t is your, that at which value you want to find out the value of y, right? So at t, at the position of t, it will come 4, because we want to find out y4. And after that, function is your, this is the function, that is 2x minus 1 is the function. So this is the meaning of ODE. So y equal to ODE, y naught, t naught, t and f. F is your function. T is your at which value you want to find out the value of the y, at which value of x, right? You want to find out the value of y. Y naught is the initial value at time t is equal to 0, or at time t is equal to 3, or at time t is equal to 2, whatever has been given to you, right? So this is your ODE function. For example, that is, let us consider one example that we have written here. That is dy by dx, the function is your dy by dx minus sine twice x is equal to 0, right? and it is giving the initial condition at x equal to 0, y not equal to 0. That means what we have done, that dy by dx, we will take every term we will take in the right hand side. So we are getting dy by dx equal to sine twice x. So this is the function we have done. We know y not equal to 0, it has been given. And also it is given x not equal to 0, because at time x equal to 0, what is y? Right? First of all, you have to only solve. Here we have not given that at time t is equal to 4, what will be the value of y? And any range of values you can take. Now let us see that how we will solve in case of Scilab. So what we have written, because we know that how to write the function. So we have written one function, right? Function y dot, right? This is the output variable, as you know. This is the function name f, right? This is the function name. And within the function name, there are two parameters we have given. One is your x, another is your y, right? So we are giving that sine twice x. You have seen that our function is your only the dy by dx equal to sine twice x. So here we are writing that y dot, that is your output variable, is equal to sine twice x. And this x we will input, right? After that, we are giving that AND function. This x is your at which value you want to find out, right? So we are giving y not equal to 0, x not equal to 0. And since x for x, no particular value they have asked in the question, so we are taking that x equal to 1 to 100 with the step size is 0.1, right? So we are giving y is equal to ODE. This is your y naught, that is your 0. This is your x naught, right? This is your x, what we have given x, right? If you know, if it has been told that you find the value of this, solve this equation for the value x equal to say 9. So we will give here x equal to 9 only. But here, since no value has been given, so we are taking that x equal to 1 to 100. So we will get in a sinusoidal equation, sinusoidal form. So x, and this is the, we are calling the function f. We are calling the function this f. When we are calling this function, this x, whatever we have given, that will be input to x. Here it is not necessary that you will give y also. You may not give. You can give just fx also, because y we are not using it, right? Or otherwise, you can give y also. If you have not used also, then also it is of no, it will not give any error. After that, you give this output, whatever you are writing, so that will come to this y. And after that, if you give the plot y, then you will get this type of sinusoidal waveform. So this is the solution of y from, we have got dy by dx equal to 2x, sine of 2x. So for example, the second order derivative function is 2y double dash, right, minus 5y dash plus y equal to 0. So this is given. We have to solve this y. And the initial function, initial value, it has been given that y 3 equal to 6 and y dash 3 equal to minus 1. That has been given, right? So what we do it, we will do some mathematical calculations. After that, we will write it into the polynomial function. So, differential equation. Then, for example, we are telling that x1t equal to, let us consider as yt, and x2t we are considering as y dash t, right? That means what? If you are telling that x1 equal to yt and x2 equal to y dash t, that means if we find the derivative of x1, that means x1 dash is equal to y dash and x2 dash equal to basically the y double dash. That means we are converting this y double dash term to the single dash, right? That means in dx2 term into dy dx or dy dt. Some other format we want to take, but we want to take in the form of just a single derivative. So that can be done, that if we consider that x2 equal to y dash, then x2 dash equal to y double dash. Here we are telling that x1 equal to y, that means x1 dash equal to y dash. So what we get y double dash from this equation, if we just replace the values of y double dash from here, then what we should get? We should get that y double dash equal to minus half into y, that means it will be minus y and then divided by 2, that is your minus half into y. It will be plus 5 by 2 into y dash. So from here we are getting that y double dash equal to this. Now what y means? Minus half into x1, because y means x1 that we have taken, and y dash means x2, that means 5 by 2 x2, right? So we have converted that y double dash in terms of x1 and x2, where x1 equal to y and x2 equal to y dash. And how we are getting that y double dash equal to, we are just replacing that y double dash value with this value, that is plus 5 y dash minus y and divided by 2. Okay, then after that, let me just or we can just erase the portion. Okay, now finally let me write it again. Y double dash equal to minus half, final line I am writing again, plus 5 by 2 x2, that we have got it, right? And we have the initial value as y3 equal to 6, and y means x1, so x1 3 equal to y3 equal to 6, that is our initial value. And y dash 3 equal to minus 1, that means x2 3, that is equal to y dash 3, that is equal to minus 1, that is given. That means we are converting in terms of x1 and x2. So these are the two values. Now if we say that if we want to write the function, then what we should write? Now you are writing the function. For example, we are writing that function, any function, that is output is equal to dx equal to, we are telling that f within bracket, say we are telling that any variable t comma x, let us take, right? Now here if we write that only dx, but we have the two solutions, one is your y, another is your y dash, two solutions we will get, right? So we can do it like this, that dx1, the first value will be the, you know, that is your, say, first value is your, say, x2. Say, for example, this is your x2 we are telling, right? And dx2 will be basically minus x1 by 2, right? It can be the first x value, and plus 5 by 2 into x2. Why we are telling it x2? Because x2 is equal to what we are telling? X2 is equal to y dash, right? So first value is your y dash, and next is your y double dash. So minus half into x1 plus 5 by 2 into x2. That's why we are taking the first value, it will be stored into your x1, dx1, and second value, it will be stored in your dx2. So we are getting that y double dash and y dash. So how will you find the solution? This is your end function. This will be your just, you just end the function, right? Now, when you will write the ODE, then let me just erase that one, or I can write it here, right? So let us take the ODE. So we are telling that solve any variable. We are telling that ODE it should come, right? Now we have the two initial values. One is your 6, another is your minus 1. At value, what time? T is equal to 3. So we are telling that one is your 6. Otherwise, we had to give that y naught t naught. Here we are giving the y naught 1, y naught 2. So one is your 6. And then another variable is your minus 1. After that, we are giving that initial value, that is your at t is equal to 3. So we are giving 3. Now, for example, you want to find, as I have told you, that at what time, what value of x you want to find out y. For example, the value at 4, we want to find the value of this solution. And after that, the function, whatever function you have given, I have given the f. So you can call this function f. After that, you can just give that display. Now again, you will be getting the two values of solve, right? So you can give the SOL 1, you will get y, and if you give the SOL 2, then you will get y dash. But generally, you want that solve y only. We want, so you, if you give the only the display SOL 1, then also you will get the value of y at x equal to 3, right? So this way we can just solve the second order derivative. Any order derivative function, you can convert it into the first order derivative, and after that you can solve it with the help of the ODE only. But depending on this, if you have the 3 or 4 initial values, then you have to give it with the help of the matrix form, right? So this was about that, how to solve the second order derivative. Now let me go to the signal processing toolboxes. As you know that in signal processing, basically the electronics and the computer science people and the electrical people will be much interested in signal processing toolbox. As you know that signal processing is the core area of any processing, right? Whenever you want to do any image processing also, then also you need somewhat your basic idea of signal processing, that how to carry out the signal, how to transmit the signal, what are the compression techniques you can use in the signal, what are the filtering techniques you can use in the signal, what are the transform techniques you can use in the signal. Right? How to transfer the signal from one place to another with less of, you know, the error and with more signal to noise ratio, and also the compression will be more in the signal. So as we get the more compression in the signal, automatically the quality decreases and the during the reconstruction. But anyway, why you will do the image processing toolbox also, it is not possible just within 1 hour you can complete the signal processing toolbox. But anyway, I will just go one by one command what is important in signal processing that we will do. You know that 1D signal is a function of a single independent variable, and for example, speech signal and audio signal, these are one dimensional signal, right? But 2D signal, the example is your image, where we will get the position of the x and y, right? And multidimensional signal is the more than your one variable. For example, video signal is the multidimensional signal, right? Where you will get x and y with respect to time. So the signal can be generated by a single source or multiple sources. So single source we are taking as your scalar value, and when we say the multiple sources, we take as your vector value. This is a very small example that you already have done this command, that the random function, this is your random function 1 to 10, then you can use the subplot and then you can use the plot, right? Similarly, random function 1 to 20, 1 to 15, 1 to 24, 25. And accordingly, the subplot will change from 1, 2, 3, and 4. So in the fourth subplot, you can plot the signals. Okay, now this also you know that I have told you yesterday that the handler, right? Graphics handler, GCA, where we use the GCA in the when we have used the greet command, then we have used the GCA, set equal to GCA we have given. So again, GCA is needed when your, you know, the current, you want to handle the current axis, that where the X location will be there. So what we have done here, T is equal to 1 to 50, right? Y is equal to one random function, what we have given, any values, right? And plot T comma Y, that is a simple plotting. But here main thing is there, that how to, you know, the locate the X value, X level in the middle of this. So you have to use the handler. So what we have done, that A is equal to GCA, A dot, A is your one, you can say one object, right? One object of this class. And then A dot X location equal to middle, you have set the property of X location. Then similarly, A dot parent dot background is equal to 4, right? And you are giving that X title. What do you want the X title? So you have located that X location should be in the middle. Background will be in the some color. And your title will be this. My title, my X axis and volume. I have told you that in X title, you can give the title of the graph. You can give the level of X. And you can also give the level of Y. So you can just try it. You can just note down. I suppose that you are noting down this statement, so that you can just try it and practice it, right? Kindly note it down. Okay, now it is your generation of the signal, right? Generation of the signal in the sense that how to generate the sine wave, how to generate the cos wave, that you know already. We have done sine twice pi ft, right? And this is your twice pi, and t is your value we have given, and then with the help of this GCA, we have taken the text, we have taken the Y level text, we have used the plot 2D, and that way you can manipulate that how to generate your sine wave generation and cosine wave generation. After that, the term sampling is very important in case of the signal. When we transfer the analog signal, any type of signal, it may be the telephone signal, it may be the, you know, voice, whatever signal you are generating. So it is the real life, we can generate only the analog signal. But when we want to process it digitally, then you have to convert it digital into digital signal. Mm. So before the converting into digital signal, we do the sampling, right? So what do you mean by the sampling? We know that sampling frequency, Nyquist theorem, it said that sampling frequency should be greater than the twice the maximum of your frequency of the input signal. So this is one program that how to get the sampled signal. Kindly you do and practice it now in Scilab. So what we have done, F naught equal to input frequency of the sine wave in hertz. That means you are inputting the frequency of the sine wave. And after that, you give the sampling frequency also. You know the sampling frequency should be more than the twice the maximum of the this frequency. Here only the frequency is your F naught. So with respect to this, it should be FTU should be greater than twice F naught. After that, what we are doing that T period is your 0 to 1 with the help of this, you know, that step size is your 0.01. So first of all, what we have done? We have done X equal to sine twice pi FT. Here we have done sine twice pi, that is your 3.14 F, that is your F naught, and then is your T. So we are using the subplot, we are using GCA, then X level text is equal to time, amplitude, and plot X, right? That we are telling that X title is equal to continuous signal. Up to this, only the, it is the continuous signal. Right? So from here, we are getting the frequency, we are getting the sampling frequency, we are getting T. This I have not told till yet. Main bataungi isko. Then after that, we are doing the X, we are doing the subplot, GCA, X level text, Y level text, plot, and continuous signal. So we are getting somewhat about this signal, right? That is your sinusoidal signal. Now we should get the sample values. Sample values means this way we should get some values, right? So whatever value sample signal we should get. So what we have done that if I get that, twice pi ft, then we this replace this t with n capital T. That means if we want to do the sampling, we replace t with n capital T, where n is your, it can be 1, 2, 3 to this, and t is basically your time period. So what do you know? What is the time period? Time period, we know that 1 by f, that is your time period. So here that we have done, that capital T is equal to 1 by ft. That means you are giving the time period of this frequency. This is your sampling frequency, and you are finding the time period as 1 by f. So what, when we are doing the t, you are getting the t, that is your 1 by f. After that, how you, it is multiplying twice pi f, and with this is your constant, twice pi f. This is your 2 into pi into f naught. And here it is only t we are giving. Here we are giving in the sample signal, we are giving after replacing t with nt. So it is, we are giving nt. And what is your t that we have done 1 by f? And what is your n? N may be your 0, 1, 2, 3, 2 maximum values of ft. So n is your the integer values 0 to ft. So that way we are getting these values. We are then again subplot, again a, again time, again amplitude. Now, as I have told you, when yesterday we have done plot 2D command, I have told you two commands, plot 2D2 and plot 2D3. Plot 2D3 is basically the step size, right? So here we will get, we will give the plot 2D3 command, and here we will get this type of sample signal. When you will plot it, you will get such type of sample signal. So first one signal is your continuous signal, and second one signal is your sample signal. So this is the question you have to do, that draw the step signal, ramp signal, and the exponential function. So step signal, as we know, this is your step signal. Ramp signal is this. Exponential is this. So you can just write a function or a program how to plot this step signal. If you find the y, that what should be y, and if you give the plot 2D3 then y, then automatically you will get with the help of this, with the help of the samples, right? All the in the same size, because step size is equal to actually 1 at all the values, for all the values that t is greater than 0. So that is your step function. Then similarly ramp function, similarly exponential function. This you can try it later on also. Okay, next term in signal processing is your convolution. This is not the term, that is whether we need it in the signal processing and we don't need in the image processing and video processing. These are the terms where it is applicable in all the processing of the signals, right? When you want to do this convolution, convolution is basically that if you know the, you know, the response of the impulse signal from a system, and if you know the, you know, the transfer function, then you can find out the output of the system. Basically what happened that let me see that, for example, when we can find out the output, if we give any input to any system, when we find the output, if you know the transfer function of this system, right? If you know the transfer function of a system and if you know the input, then easily you can find out the output of the system. Now question is, for example, the transfer function is not available to you, right? You don't know the system, the transfer function, that means it is a black box, right? but you want that output you should get. But another input you have been given, for example, the transfer function is not given to you, but you know the what is the response of the system, when impulse signal is input. That means you don't know the transfer function, but you know that what will be the response of the system. That means output, you know, if the x equal to is your delta n, that means delta is your just an impulse signal. Impulse signal is what? Impulse signal is only at time t is equal to 0, it will be 1. At time t is equal to 0, it will be 1, and the other values of x will be, you know, 0 at all the time t is greater than or less than 0. Only at t is equal to 0, the value will be 1. This is your impulse signal. So it says that if x equal to delta n, that means if you input any, you know, delta n to a system, then the what will be the output, that you know, that you have. And the output we are telling, that is your H, right? That is H means that is the response of a system when the impulse signal is input. So you know X, right? You know X and you know H. X is your input and H is your the impulse response. That means response when the input is your impulse. So if you know these two values, the convolution says that convolution can give the output that if you do the convolution of x and h, then automatically you can calculate y. So that is the significance of the convolution. Convolution is nothing but the the multiplication and addition of the signal, right, with the multiplication and addition of the signals, with the help of input and the impulse response, you can find out the output. Now for this, we use the CONV. In case of Scilab and MATLAB, we use the function CONV for the convolution. So CONV A comma B, right, and the shape is optional. In the shape, you can give the full or you can give the same, right? If you give the full, that means all the elements will come. Whatever elements, whatever calculations will be done in convolution, every element values you will see. But if you give the same, then the values, the number of values will be the size of the first matrix, right? First signal. So if your A contains the 7 values, B contain the, for example, again 8 values, then if you give full, then you will get that size of A plus size of B minus 1. That means 7 plus 8 minus 1. That means 14 values you will get. But if you give same, then you will get only the up to the size of A, that is 7 values only, you will be shown. It will be shown, right? So this is the difference between the shape, full and same. So let us see that how the Scilab helps us to do this. Okay, so let us take A is equal to any values, any matrix values we are taking, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, right? And say B is equal to any matrix we are giving, 4, 5, 6, 7, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Right? Now, if you say that convolution, say CONV A comma B, and we are not giving any full or something, CONV A comma B, if you are giving, then you are giving the 16 values, right? You are getting the 16 values. So here we have how much? We have in case of A, we have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 values. and 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16, 17. So 17 minus 1, that means your 16 values here you are getting. And if you give the same, if you write that same, then you see that how many values you are getting. You are getting 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, right? Because here in A, we have given the 7 values. So here also you are getting the 7 values. This is your convolution simple CONV. Now let us see that CONV2. This is also the discrete 2D convolution, same as your CONV only. So if you give the CONV2 A comma B, then similarly shape is there full and same. Then you can just write that how the output is coming. It is similar as your CONV only. For example, we have given some Sobel operator we have written that is used for the edge detection in case of image processing. Sobel filter, you can say. So we are giving the values S equal to 1 to 1, 0, 0, 0, minus 1, minus 2, 1. And we are putting some A is equal to, some 1, 1, 1 and some zeros are there with the help of this 10 and 10. Now we are putting convolution 2. So what you are getting, that you can just check. And after that, what we are giving here, that we are giving that S is basically the Sobel operator, one matrix only you can give. Or otherwise, you can give some, some values. You can just do it. You can just check it that U and V, the matrix also you can give, U comma V, and then you can give A. Whereas U and V, the multiplication, right? So you can just check it, you can just copy it and shift it, paste it into the Scilab, then you can see the output. And here you can just say that some P is equal to convolution 2, and after that you can plot it also. So both these values, you can just check it and check it that whether they are okay or not, equal or not. Here the value should be equal, because I have taken those type of values only, that is matrix. Basically, A can be the one single matrix, or this single matrix can be, the converted into the row matrix and the column matrix. So H row and H column, right? It is a, so with this value also you can give. So I have given the two ways. One is your complete matrix, another is your row matrix and the column matrix. So that this multiplication becomes the S. So you will get the same values. So you can just check it, copy it and paste it into the, Scilab environment. Okay, you must have done the convolution. Then let us see what you mean by the transform. That is your Fourier transform. By name only we can understand that Fourier series, it must be related with Fourier series. And Fourier transform is basically to convert any time domain signal into the frequency domain, and it is needed because in the frequency domain only we can analyze the signal. When you find out the power spectrum of the signal, when do you find out the signal to noise ratio of the signal, process signal, when do you find out to compress the any signal, everything you can do only with the help of this frequency domain signal. So that's why it is very much required in signal processing, that whenever you get the analog domain or the time domain signal, not in analog domain, you can convert it into the Fourier transform. So here we are telling that discrete Fourier transform, because we are converting into digital signal processing. So we are using the DFT. right? So the DFT is basically that you find out the frequency domain and then you discretize the frequency domain signal, right? So it is the command is your DFT only, that you give the any output variable, that is XF and DFT of X, and if you give flag, so flag is equal to, if it is minus 1, then it will give the DFT, and flag is equal to 1, that means it will give the inverse DFT, right? So for example, DFT command can be done with the help of the FFT also, fast Fourier transform. The difference between the DFT and FFT is that in case of fast Fourier transform, the computation is less, that's why it is fast, right? In DFTs, the computation is more, so that was the time complexity is more in case of the DFT. So that's why we can use the DFT command or we can use the FFT command to calculate the discrete Fourier transform. So in FFT also it is same, that A is your the signal, and if it is you give the flag is your minus 1, then we will get the Fourier transform, and if you give the signal the values as your plus 1, that means you are calculating the IFFT. So let us give one example. Say this is the example, right? So we are telling that N is equal to 8, right? Omega is equal to minus twice pi, minus twice pi, omega means what? Twice pi f, right? Minus twice pi f. So this is your exponential. This is one value we have taken. I'm just telling you. This is just a, you know, that is a, you know, expression we have taken, e to the power minus twice pi j n. What, how you will say? Say, for example, we are telling x equal to, sorry. Say, let me just explain it. Okay, let us take the input as your 1 to 8, we are telling, that is your 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, right? After that, we are converting x2 into the column matrix, so it will be converted into 1 to 8, right? Now, this portion is not... okay. Though the function we have done, that is your f into x, just 1 minute. E to the power minus j omega. Okay, let me see that. I'll just tell you that what here, why I have written this F, because it is not needed basically for the calculations. So if we say that simple, if we just say that if we give that x equal to 128, and then if we can just write it that FFT of x, and then you say minus 1, then also we'll get the result, right? And similarly, if we say that if it is equal to, say, z equal to, you are telling that FFT of x comma minus 1, that is your FFT. And if you do the opposite, that means if you say that x equal to will be FFT of z, and it will be 1, that means you will get the original value of x, right? So what I have written here, that is not needed. I'll just check it up that why I have written maybe into why it is needed, right? So it is not needed now that this portion, that is your omega, and this portion is not needed. Only you can just note down I'll just explain it. This portion now it is not needed. Only the command you need, that is your x equal to this FFT of this. Either you can do the DFT also, and FFT of this, and this, and this. So these four commands, you can just write it and note it down. That is how to find the DFT and how to find the FFT. Now another command is your FFT shift. This is nothing but that to shift your FFT from the origin. If your FFT is there, then automatically you can shift the FFT signals into the either in the positive side or in the negative side. So it rearranges the FFT output. It has written moving the zero frequency to the center of the spectrum. Wherever you want to move, you can move, right? This is just a shifting of your FFT. Sometimes we need for filtering case, before filtering and all these things, you need the shifting of the signal or the Fourier transform or the, you know, the frequency signal. That time we need this FFT shift. So we have, I have written some small program for this FFT shift, that how it looks like. So you can just check it up. That is your T I have given 0 to 1000, then X signal we have given. We have calculated the FFT, right? Here also we are calculating the FFT Y, and then we are giving the plot FFT shift Y, right? Absolute Y means all the values will be positive. Similarly, we are taking the inverse FFT. Here we are taking the FFT. Here also we are taking the FFT. Then finally, this is your value of X, and this is the different value of X. And we are calculating the subplot, and that is your plotting of the other signals, that is FFT signal. Here another command we have used, that is your matplot, MAT plot. This is also another command, that matplot, right, for plotting. This is the different plotting command. So you can just note down this, syntax is, then you can practice it afterwards when we'll complete. So this is your for the FFT shifting. So T is equal to this, X is equal to this, and then you can just calculate the FFT shift. And after that, you can just plot this Y and FFT shift Y. So you can just check it that what is the function of FFT shift. Another command is your multidimensional FFT, that is your MFFT. Now for the correlation, we have the X core, and for the covariance, we have the X curve, right? These are the two functions we use in case of the signal processing. One is your to find out the correlation of two signals, and another is your covariance of two signals. These are the two functions you can just try, you can just take the help from the, you know, Scilab, then you can just try these two functions. So these are your signal processing functions. And next, let me give you the concept of filtering. So this is also another part of signal processing, that is your to design the filter. So filter may be the analog filter and the digital filter. That means if you use the filter in the analog signals, then it will be the analog filter. And if you use the filter in the digital signal, then it will be known as your digital filter. In case of digital filter, there are two filters are available. One is your FIR filter, finite impulse response filter, and another is your IIR, that is your infinite impulse response filter. What do you mean by filter? Filter, you know that if you you know that if you have the signal, for example, say if you have any signal, for example, this is the signal, right? If you get the digital signal, then you can use this type of signal, right? Now, if you want the to filter the signal, that means it can be of four types of filter. One can be your low pass filter, another is your high pass filter, another is your band pass filter, and fourth one is your band stop filter, right? Filter. So these are the four filters. So low pass filter means that you pass the low frequency, not like this, you pass the low frequency and you stop the high frequency, right? So this is your the low band frequency which you are passing, right? And the stop frequency you are getting zero, you are giving zero, so that the higher frequency components become zero. Low pass filter is very much applicable in case of the speech processing or the audio signal processing, because in case of speech signal, it has a very significant information only in the low frequency component. So that's why we use the low pass filter in case of the you know, signal processing or the audio processing. High pass filter is your that you stop the low frequency, but you pass the high frequency components. That means in for some band, you just stop it and you just pass the high frequency component. Similarly is your band pass. Band pass means some, you know, band you should pass, and for the other band, other frequency, for more than this and the less than this, that the value will be zero. And you pass the frequency, the signal through for the some specific band. And band stop filter is your just an opposite, where you stop for some band and other frequency you should pass. So you are passing this and you are passing this and the other portion you are stopping. So these are the main four types of the filters you can design, either in case of digital filter or in case of the analog filter. So if you give the simple filter command, we get this filter command. Just let me erase this. So we have the filter command, that is your y is equal to filter, numerator, denominator, and x. When we say the numerator and denominator, that is basically the transfer function of the system, right? What do you want? For example, I must have given this. For example, numerator is equal to one matrix and denominator is your another matrix, and A is your the input signal which you want to filter. And numerator and denominator are the values of the filter function. That means you can give, when you pass through a filter, that is your low pass filter, then you get the output. As I have told that whenever you pass through a system, the transfer function of the system you should be knowing. Right, then only you can find out the y. So here also we are passing through a low pass filter, and you pass the transfer function of z, that is your hz, because we are giving the, you know, that yn or xn. So you are giving the Z transform or the numerator transfer function. What is the numerator of this and what is the denominator of this? So something in the numerator coefficient, something in the denominator coefficient. So filter coefficient, it will give the all the filter coefficient of this. So filter means that numerator and denominator, that is your transfer function of the filter, and this is your input signal, right? Whatever output you will give, if you plot it, then you can find out that what is the filtered output of this signal. Signal means X. Now let us see that what do you mean by the FIR low pass filter and how to draw the low pass filter. So in low pass filter, what do we want? In low pass filter, when you draw the low pass filter, as I have told, this is your low pass filter, right? So you what do you want? You want the cutoff frequency. This is known as your cutoff frequency, that is your P, that up to which the signal will pass, right? So this is your input, that is your enter the cutoff frequency. After that, you are giving the order of the filter. That you should give in each and every filter design, you should give the order of the filter, right? And another is your the sampling frequency. As you know, I have told you that what should be the sampling frequency. Sampling frequency will be every time twice of the more than twice of the this cutoff frequency or the frequency of the signal. So here what we are doing, we are using the WFIR. There is a technique, that is your window technique of designing the finite impulse response. The window technique is for this window technique FIR design, we use the this WFIR command, that is your WFIR, and we are calculating the low pass filter, right? We are giving the order of the filter, that is N. We are giving the WC0. Since we are using the low pass filter, we are giving WC0. If you WC is what? WC is your normalized frequency, that is equal to FP, that is your cutoff frequency divided by the sampling frequency. That is known as your normalized frequency. In technical term, it is known as your normalized frequency. So that is your WC, that is your normalized frequency. And when you will design the low pass filter, you will give WC0. When you will give the high pass filter, then you will give 0 WC. When you will give the band stop filter, you will get WC1 and WC2. There will be two frequency. So that time you have to give the WC1 and WC2. HM is your Hamming window that you have to give. That which type of, as I have told, this is your windowing filter. So what type of window you are giving, that is you have to designate. Here we are using HM, that is your Hamming window. Otherwise you can give the rectangular window, you can give the Henning window, you can give the Kaiser window, you can give the Blackman window, any type of window you can give, right? And after that, this output is coming, that is your coefficient, then frequency amplitude, that means frequency component amplitude, and frequency component key frequency. So there are two values. One is your frequency component, another is your amplitude component. So after that, you can plot this, and with the help of plot, you can get the FIR low pass filter. You can just note down this thing, and you can directly, you can just copy it and paste it into the, you can just note down and you can just copy it into your Scilab window. And after that, whenever you will plot it, you can find out that what type of plot it is giving. It should be giving the this type of plot. As I have told you, it is a low pass, so it should give just like this. right? So when we have written the program, we are writing that fp equal to enter the cutoff frequency, then n is equal to input enter the order of the filter, then we are giving the enter the the sampling frequency. After that we are normalizing it, that is wc equal to fp by f, and we are using the wfir filter. That is, here we are using the low pass filter, then n, then wc0, then hemming window, then this is your default, this is 00, because we are not giving any ripples, that's why it is 00. And after that we are plotting this and we are showing this. Now if you enter the cutoff frequency, I am entering the 50 and order of the filter is 8 and the sampling frequency is 100, then automatically you can see the output as this thing. So this is the design of a low pass filter. So similarly, you can use the same command and you can use for giving the high pass filter or something. Okay, so this is another example to carry out the infinite impulse response of low pass filter. For this we are using the IIR command only. Here we are using the IIR command. Same we are doing, that is your cutoff frequency, you have to input the order of the filter, you have to input the sampling frequency. After that we are using the normalized frequency, that is fp by f. And after that, when you are calculating the IIR filter, we are using the IIR, then n is your order of the filter, then lp, that is your low pass filter you are designing, and for high pass filter hp, for band pass filter bp, and for band stop filter sb, ulta, not bs, it will be sp, sb. Then after that, in case of IIR filter, we use the different, that is your Butterworth filter or Chebyshev filter or elliptic filter, right? So we are using here Butterworth filter, so we are giving the BUTT. Otherwise you can use the Chebyshev filter, that is your CHEV1 or CHEV2, or elliptic filter you can give ELLIP. Similarly, we have given the cutoff frequency and the ripples are zero, right? So we are getting the output at 8Z. From 8Z, when we are output, we are getting at 8Z. Then from 8Z, we are getting the frequency component and the magnitude component with the help of the FR mag. FR magnitude, that means frequency magnitude command, this command, we are using that this one, this FR MAG command we are using for to find out the frequency and magnitude. That means frequency and magnitude means the frequency component. For the frequency components, what are the magnitude of the frequency component and actual what are the frequencies. So we can plot that with FR and HZM, then you can get the frequency components of this. And after that you can just write all these things, X title and this, then you can just get the low pass filter of the this IIR design. Similarly, we can calculate, we can see that how the high pass filter are designed. And this is basically what I have told, that Butterworth filter, Chebyshev filter type 1 and Chebyshev filter type 2, CHEB1 and CHEB2, that is your Chebyshev filter type 1 and type 2, and elliptic filter, right? These are the four filters are used in case of the analog filter design, right? So you can carry out this analog filter design with this command, that is your ANALPF. Right, analog filter design. So that is ANALPF that is your n is your order of the filter. This is the design of the filter. You can give chef 1, chef 2, elip or butterworth, and after that you can give the, you know, the ripples. That is your, in butterworth there will be no ripples, because we get in butterworth, what is the design of the butterworth filter, I'll just show you, then you will understand that what are, how these values have been given, 0.1 and 0, 0, 0.1, 1, 0.1 and 0.1, and here we have given 0. So in case of butterworth, we get this type of designing, right? This is your butterworth filter. Chebyshev 1 filter, we get actually the ripples in the pass band, and in the stop band, there will be no ripples. This is your Chebyshev 1. In case of Chebyshev 2, we get the pass band and ripples in the stop band. So this is your Chebyshev 2. And in elliptic filter, we get the ripples in both the sides, in pass band and is your stop band. That's why if there is no ripples, then we are giving here 0, 0. If there is a ripple in the pass band and no ripple in the stop band, therefore we have written here 0.1, then 0. That means in the pass band we are getting the ripple as your 0.1, in the stop band we are getting 0. Similarly, in case of the Chebyshev 2, we are giving the value 0, 0.1. That means in the pass band there will be no ripples, and in the stop band we are getting the ripples as your 0.1. And in case of the elliptic one, we are getting 0.1, 0.1. That means in the pass band also we are giving ripple at 0.1, and in the stop band also we are giving ripple at 0.1. After that you are giving cutoff frequency, you are converting into the omega twice pi f. So we are giving this type of signal. So when you just copy it and you will let me erase all these things, and let us go back to the design form. And if we just copy it and paste it into the Scilab function, let us see what we will get. We should get all the filter design and frequency response, just like I have drawn here, right? Let me copy it and we will just paste it into the Scilab synodes. Right, okay, so this is the signal you have got. This is the signal. So the greenish signal is basically the Butterworth filter. This one is a Butterworth filter. Red color, it is showing that Chebyshev filter. No, red color, it is showing the elliptic filter, because in red color you are getting the ripples in the stop band as well as ripples in the pass band. After that you are getting the blue one, you are getting the ripple in the pass band and no for your stop band, no ripple in the stop band. That means this is your Chebyshev 1. And another one you are getting in yellow color. In yellow color, what you are getting, that is in the pass band there are no ripples, but in the stop band there are ripples. That means this is the graph of the Chebyshev 2, right? So this way you can just design the the filters, that is your analog filter. It may be the Butterworth, maybe Chebyshev 1, maybe Chebyshev 2, and maybe elliptic one. So in this actually we have told about this basics of the signal processing and also the filter commands. With the help of filter commands, you can calculate the FIR filter design or IIR filter design in low pass filter or high pass filter. And finally, you can design the analog filters also.